Great to welcome back Dr. Chris Stride from the University of Sheffield. Remember Chris talked about sporting statues before, but this week we're going to get why adults adopted replica football kit. That's a mouthful. Chris.
Hi, thanks. Good evening. Okay, so I'll see a few of you wearing replica kits here already. So I adjusted the colour on my thing. Even though it doesn't show it there, it actually looks yellow and blue on that. That's actually amber and claret. It's just the projector's mangled it a bit. It was previously properly yellow and blue, so it looked like these. I've got to change this very quickly. Okay, so what I'm going to talk about today is why there are some of you sat here wearing replica shirts, which if you'd come into this place about, well, it wasn't here obviously, but if you'd come in here 40 years ago, there wouldn't be anybody sat round wearing replica shirts. It just didn't happen, it wasn't a thing. And it's something I looked into about 4 or 5 years ago now. I'd done some research on football kit design, and I was interested in how design had changed over the years. And what I noticed was that there was a much more rapid change in design once replica shirts became a thing. And that got me thinking, well, why on earth is it that people wear replica shirts? Why? When did this start? When did it become a thing? And then I thought, well, I'll see if I can work out when that happened. And that might be able to help me work out why it happened. So often the when is linked to the why and the how. So I approached it very much as, well, I'm going to actually look at the crowd, because you'll see in a minute that's basically what I did. I'm going to look at football crowds. And here's just a little brief. I mean, obviously there's black and white going through to colour there. But if we look at the crowds, we can say straight away that in 1910, nobody was wearing replica shirts. They were wearing the sort of Peaky Blinders caps. And then 1936, they're still wearing those caps. There's maybe a few more top hats. And then 1958, a few less caps. People dared to take them off by that point. 1972, the caps have gone and people are wearing scarves. And then by 1999, there's a crowd at Wolves and you can see a load of replica shirts showing up. So that suggests that the time when this happened is somewhere between 1972 and 1999. But I wanted to pinpoint it more accurately than that. And I thought, well, I'm going to look at this in sort of four dimensions. We'll look at the idea of production. At what point were adult sizes produced for sales of replicas, to fans? So I wanted to look at production. I wanted to look at promotion. So,
One, two.
That's fed up. Okay. There's a lesson here. Always bring all your own kit. Last time I brought my own projector. I normally do. Right. So, secondly, promotion. At what point do clubs or manufacturers start promoting shirts for sale to adults? So I'm going to have a look at that as well. Then purchasing. At what point do we have some evidence that replica shirts are being bought by adults? And then finally, parading. Let's just get the P's lined up. At what point can we see that adults are actually wearing them out, showing them off? Okay, so first one, production. I started looking at production. How am I going to do that? Well, I tried the manufacturers, and they were absolutely useless because most of them just hadn't kept records of this sort of stuff. Just didn't exist. And then I thought, well, I'm going to have to look at what was actually for sale. So I looked at catalogues, and that was a little bit better. I looked at club shop catalogues, manufacturers' own catalogues that were still out there on the internet or in the archives at various places. And I interviewed a few of the manufacturers as well. So I got in touch with people who used to work at Umbro, got in touch with people who used to work at Admiral, and talked to them. What about promotion? Well, researching promotion is much easier because you're just looking for old adverts. So old match day programs are a really good source of adverts for shirts. And manufacturers as well tend to have their own adverts they place in magazines like Shoot and Match and magazines as well. purchasing. And that's a bit hard because club shops don't keep inventories of what they sold, sadly. I tried that initially and I found club shops had no records of what they sold at all. They just brought it away at the end of the year. So I did a survey there. I surveyed fans across the Premier League and the Football League and asked them, when did you start buying replica kits? And I had about 4,000 responses, which was amazing. We just hit up every web forum for fans and people responded to it. I mean, just asking them, when did they buy their first adult size shirt? How old were they when they bought it? And then I interviewed a few club shop managers as well. So I tracked down people who used to wear in club shops in the 70s, 80s and 90s. And said, what do you remember about replica shirts? When did they take off? When did you change from selling scarves and little knickknacks like a club lamp or something like that? When did shirts become the big thing? Finally, parading. How do you research parading? Well, this is a crazy one. Really, the only way you could do this is looking at old photos of crowds. So I just spent about 6 to 9 months looking for photos of crowds, which isn't that easy because generally, photographers take photos of the action. Sometimes you get a bit of crowd in the background, but you don't often get a really good sweep of the crowd. So that took a bit of hard work, but eventually got about 800 odd photos, trying to get the same amount roughly for each year. And then just looking at those photos and counting how many people were in the crowd and how many people were wearing replica shirts. So. And obviously trying to get a range of times of year as well. You didn't want to have all summer in 1978 and then all winter in 1990 because you wouldn't see the shirts on any people's coats. Okay, so this is what I found. So this is all about the when. So production. Well, this is where it gets a little bit complicated because whilst I'm going to place the date for replica shirts starting to be produced much later, it has actually been possible to buy your team's kit from when football began, once teams started wearing kits. Because obviously, you could go in and say, I'm a player and I want the kit. I play for an amateur team. I want a new white shirt or a new blue shirt that happened to be the same colour as the team you supported. You could get hold of the shirt. So here's an example of that. This is from the Derby Telegraph, 1885. And important notice to football players, Derby County colour shirts, scarves and sashes to match can be obtained at W.G. Basford's in James Street in Derby. Now, the key word there is football players. So they are selling Derby shirts, no doubt, black shorts and socks as well. To little note, people didn't know this until like 1960s. Teams really didn't have different coloured shorts, their own shorts. You could only get shorts in black, white and navy. That's why all teams tended to play in black, white or navy shorts. Anyway, what they're saying here is, if you've got a bunch of lads who've got a football team and you want to wear the same colour kit to Derby, you can do, go to our shop and buy one. They're not selling them as replicas to be worn to show off you're a Derby fan. They're selling them as sportswear, and that's a different thing. So you've always been able to obtain the shirt, but what about them actually being marketed as replicas? Well, the first real evidence of that comes in the late 1950s. So Umbro launched something called the Umbro set. This was designed for children. Key point, it's designed for children. Child size only. In a nice little box, you've got your shirt, your shorts, and your socks. So it's designed for children, and it's giving you the shirts, shorts, and socks. Again, it's designed for the kid to go and play in the garden in. But it is marketed in a way that it is very much, this is a replica, here's the one for a particular team. You can pretend to be a star player. You can pretend to be, for instance, I think they were initially, it's quite an interesting thing there, the first Umbro sets, branded Matt Busby Umbro sets. Very quickly, they became Dennis Law Umbro sets. The idea being that a child wouldn't really want to pretend to be Matt Busby. Sort of that change from the 1950s, where society was still very much structured in age hierarchies, and you'd want to look up to your dad, and then to the 1960s, where the kids wanted to be the kids, and they wanted to be Dennis Law, but they didn't want to be their dad. Anyway, that's really the first sort of evidence of replicas. Other companies cottoned onto this, or Umbro was onto a good thing here, and they all started making their own replicas too. So you can see here, there's an advert, you can't see very clearly, but that's for a company called Blundstones. And they've got two children, one wearing a sort of England shirt, one wearing a Chelsea shirt. And there's an advert, and that's actually a very early Admiral advert. That's from 1972 or 73. Now, the key point on this, you can't see it in the picture, but underneath this, there was a thing saying, listing the different kits on there. And for this one here in the middle, the white one, it said England/Derby/Spurs. Okay. So there are two things going on here. Before 1974, kit designs were not copyrighted. So me, you, anybody could set up our own little clothing company and make the England kit. And nobody could do anything about it. No one would think about doing anything about it. The second thing is, in this era, kits were quite plain. So it was very easy to just take a white shirt and say that's Spurs, Derby, or England. Not so bad job. There you go. So whilst it was very easy for people to buy something and treat it as a replica, and it was easy for companies to make it and say it's a replica, those replicas had less personal value. They're not as authentic, because any kid could take a white t-shirt and say, I'm playing as England. Now, in some ways, that's great. There's a sort of naive innocence about that, isn't there? That any kid down the park put a white t-shirt on and pretend to be England without coughing up a load of money or making their parents cough up a load of money. But it's clearly not exploiting the commercial value as much as you could to. And eventually, the manufacturers cottoned onto this and thought, well, this industry, there's this little cottage industry, basically, of companies making kits. But it could be a lot, lot bigger. The person who actually cottoned onto this first was a guy called Bert Patrick, and he ran Admiral. Admiral were a kit manufacturer that he'd started, but basically were a subdivision of a wider company called Cooks, who made underwear in Leicester. And so he thought, well, I can make some sportswear as well in my factory. So he started doing this in the late 60s. And then by the mid 70s, he thought, well, I can make a lot more money doing this because everybody's making the same kits and claiming they're the kits. Of course, that means there's no real authenticity. It's like there's no one real kit. There's no way a kid can say, I've got the proper one. And that would be a thing kids would love to be able to do. So he cut a deal with Leeds United. They were the first company where this happened. He went to Don Revy. And Don Revy, a man known for liking a little bit of money on the side, was quite happy to sign up to this. And he offered Leeds United £10,000 for the exclusive right to make their kits. Their kit would be an Admiral kit, and that would be the only Leeds United kit. And he used the copyright laws to copyright the shirts, and maybe could fake the Leeds United kit. And off we went. And that's the point at which replica kits really become a thing. But important to note, they're still child size. Bert Patrick at this point has not thought, I'll sell these to adults. He's thinking there's a child replica kit market already with Umbro sets and these other companies. I can make some more money out of that because kids will prefer my kits to the ones that currently exist. So kits, kit designs are copyrighted. You now start seeing the maker's name on the kit, and kits become design-wise a lot more flashy because basically you can, if you make it look very different from anyone else's kit, it's easier to sell it again as being the authentic shirt. Wouldn't much point in copyrighting it and making the shirt completely white, because then any white t-shirt would still look the same. But if he makes it white with little Admiral logos all over it, stripes down the sleeves, then anybody trying to copy that, it's a bit more bang to rights, aren't they? So kit design changes at this point as well. So by 1974 through to like 77, 78, kit design kit manufacturer is starting to move towards replica shirts, but it's only child size. There were adult sizes available of these copyrighted designs, but they didn't have the badge of. How crazy was that? So you could buy an England shirt in adult size in 1976 or something. But it wouldn't have the England badge on it. It was an adult size. If it was a kid's size, it would have the England badge. But the adult sizes wouldn't, because the idea was no adult's going to want to walk around and pretend they play for England. They might want to have the England design for their football team. So amateur teams might want to play in the same kit as England. So then they'll put their own badge on it. So you can see here's some Admiral adverts, and you can see there's a thing there saying men's sizes do not carry club badges. Mad. So it's not really, this is still nothing like the replica kit market we know today. This is selling bright coloured shirts to children. In fact, the situation is actually worse now for adult fans, if there were any out there who wanted to wear the club shirt, than it was before, because now they can't just get a white shirt and put the club badge on, because now the official shirt is this flash thing made by Admiral or Umbra or whatever. But you can't get one with a badge on. So this starts to change late 1970s. The first clubs where you start seeing replica shirts in adult sizes, and I'm by adult sizes here, I'm meaning the small to medium adults. There were fewer large adults then, but we're talking small to medium adults. Man United, Liverpool, Scotland are all available in small to medium adult size in the late 70s. So if you want to know what was the first club to have a replica shirt, that would be it. In Germany, Borussia Mönchengladbach, talking to the German historian about this, they were the first ones to be doing this as well. Completely separately, there's no link between the companies or anything. It's just, yeah, it happened at the same time. So the largest size is 38. So small to medium adult. And then what you see in terms of production is over the 80s, the largest size offers just becomes bigger. That's partly due to the growth of the population, but it also reflects that they're trying to cater for more and more adults. So that's a graph showing the biggest chest size available. This is to about 1980. That's across the 1980s. And then towards the end of the 80s, it jumps up a little bit. And then in the early 90s, it shoots right up, just like XXXXL and Dark Player and whatever you want to call it, sizes. So, and then in the 2000s, you start getting shirts in a woman's cut, another market they think they can sell to. Okay, that's production. So there's a clear sort of pattern there. Promotion. From 1959 to 77, as we talked about, it is very much oriented towards children and male children. Okay, replica shirts exist. There's the Dennis Law thing I talked about earlier. Umbro set for boys, promoted by Dennis Law. Admiral, they're promoting their shirts in 1974, and they've got a team of young boys lined up in the kits. From 77 through to 1980, starts to change a little bit. So this is a really key advert. I can't see it that clearly on the screen, but this shows a load of kids in football shirts, but these ones in the back are wearing jeans. So suddenly the kit has changed from something you play in, something you might wear down the park with your mates, or you might just hang out in on the street. It's become not just a sportswear item, it's starting to become a leisure wear item. But the majority of the advertising is still of this sort, play like your heroes. That advert there says, imagine, and it's got two children in Liverpool shirts putting a ball past Steve Grzebic, Coventry goalkeeper. So it's very much the marketing is, dress like your hero, you can be your hero. And it's marketed, again, at children. The first time you see promotion of replica shirts not to children comes in the late 70s by Admiral, but it's a little bit of a red herring. This is an advert for the old NASL kits. That's the old North American Soccer League. And their shirts were much more garish. And in fact, they look like sort of summer-like t-shirts. So we've got the Chicago Sting, Vancouver Whitecaps, New York Cosmos. And the way they're promoted, you've got there a New York police bike next to them. Guys in jeans, looking very American. And I think they weren't even being promoted necessarily to football fans. They're just being promoted to some cool summer leisure wear. But that is a breakthrough, because we've not seen that with any sportswear, football-related sportswear, before that point. The advert's really designed to appeal to fans of the US rather than the football culture, I think. But if you look at the sort of pictures that adverts used, going through from the 70s through to the 90s, there's a very clear change going on here. So up to the mid-late 80s, the adverts almost always featured children wearing the kit. From the period of the late 80s to the early 90s, they start featuring adult fans wearing the kit. And then after the mid-1990s, it reverts back to the players wearing the kit. There's this current feature, lots of players like stare like this, wearing the new shirt, don't they? There's this stuff going on. There has been actually a little range in the last few years towards fans again wearing the shirt in adverts as well. So they try different types of techniques at the moment. This is a very good example of that, actually. So these are Wolves kits adverts. This is from 1980, that's 1990. There's the Wolves Christmas souvenir shop advert from 1980. Mum and dad is in a cardigan with a little Wolves badge. Mum is in a dressing gown. And then older child is in a tracksuit and younger child is in the kit. Here's the same advert from 1990. And it's a load of young people down the pub, some of whom are wearing shirts. Completely different, isn't it? We're at the point here where young adults, even women, might even wear the shirt. Again, Umbro adverts here. A smaller period, 1987 through to 1990. 87, family. The parents, again, are wearing like leisure wear, tracksuits, cardigan, horrible cardigan. And then in 1990, we've got adult models wearing the kit. They're not Everton players. They do little. You might mention Everton that rubbish, but they were actually models. Okay, so that's promotion. Again, very clear periods. What about purchasing? Well, we did our fan survey. What happened there? Well, this is looking at the percentage of respondents age 16 plus who at that point would own an adult size replica. The period 1975 to 2015. So we asked people how old they were and what age did you buy your replica shirt is, and sort of counted back and said when you were 16, what was the year, and did you own a replica shirt? Slightly complicated maths, but you can see the proportion of people who would have owned a replica shirt at 16 by the year they were 16 has gone up. And there's a little bit of a kink there in the late 80s, which is actually ties in very much. The gradual growth during the 80s, kink up in the late 80s and climb in the early 90s and then flattens off at around 40 to 50%. This is actually more informative. You might think, oh, well, my job is a statistician, so I don't like a graph like this. This is actually much more interesting, this one here. Can't really see it on the little screen, but you might be able to see the pattern of the bars. What this shows is the decade in which first adult-sized shirt bought by the year of birth. So these are people's years of birth. So these are people who are very old now, through to people who are much younger now. It's the years they were born. And the different colours is the year in which they first bought an adult-sized shirt. And what it shows is that fans who were born in the 60s and 70s tended to buy their first adult size shirt in the 1980s. So these were people who'd maybe got into replica kits when they were kids in the 70s, and then they'd just gone straight into buying adult size replicas in the 80s. Whereas older fans, people born before 1960, actually were more likely to buy their first replica shirt in the 1990s and 2000s. So these are your people who by the 60s and 70s were grown-ups, didn't get into replica shirts in the 80s. They waited until they became more of an adult thing in the 1990s. So we can conclude from this. Basically, shirts purchased in very small numbers before 1970s. I mean, I think you did it. We found evidence from our survey. There were people who remembered being 16, 17. These were real exceptions. And they would actually go to the sports shop, buy a kit to play in of the colour of their team and wear it to games. There were a few of these people, but very, very rare. The most rapid growth in purchasing was in the late 80s. In the late 1980s, younger adult fans were more likely to purchase than older adult fans, and then the older adults catch up in the 1990s. So that's the basic pattern of purchasing. Last of the P's, parading. So we looked at these photos of clubs. Can we find any replica shirt wearers? We had a look pre-1960, not expecting to find anything, and we didn't find anything. We didn't find any adults wearing replica shirts in crowds in 1960. There must be one or two, I guess, real eccentrics, but gone to the local sports shop, bought a kit, or got their granny to knit one, and then went in. But it was dinner really happen. What did people wear? Well, people used to wear their work clothes. There's a reason for that. People just did not have as much money. They didn't have loads of sets of clothes. Also, a lot of people used to work on Saturday mornings. They'd go to football in the afternoon. So people went to football straight from work. So you tend to find people wearing their work clothes, or people really only had two or three sets of clothes. They'd have work clothes, they'd have Sunday bets, so a jacket and tie. And some people wore that to football. You see an awful lot of jacket and ties in the 40s, 50s, 60s, before. That's the World Cup final. About three quarters of the people are wearing jacket and tie. It's 1966, when apparently England was young and swinging. It certainly weren't when they were the 30s or 40s. For 30 or 40 year olds, they were still dressed in jacket and tie to go to football. From 60 to 74, we didn't find any adult shirt wearers in the crowds, but there was growing evidence of youth subcultures in the crowds. So young adults started wearing different stuff, i.e. not Sunday best. You'd see some skinheads in there, some mods. These are the sort of football mid-70s look, sort of boot boy look. Big flares, long hair, scarves around wrists. There's a few nods there. Anybody indulge in this? I haven't got any photos of butcher's coats, sadly. I know that was a thing. So basically, from these photos, if there was any adult shirt wearing going on before the mid-70s, it was ephemeral and by genuine eccentrics. These were not a regular thing. From the mid-70s through to the late 70s, we do start seeing a few replica shirts in photos, but these photos are almost exclusively from cup finals or big internationals. And they often look like adults who've squeezed into large youth sizes, which again fits in with the production information we had. The production information said they weren't making adult sizes then. So that makes total sense. If adults are wearing them, they've bought a youth size and squeezed into them. Why are they doing that? Well, I think this is about a cup final tradition rather than a shirt wearing tradition. Though it did act as a bit of a Trojan horse for shirt wearing to be adopted. Essentially, people used to wear fancy dress to cup finals. They still do. You look at the crowd at cup final, there's people dressed up in all kinds of stuff. A bit like one day cricket is now in England. People might dress up with like a weird giant FA Cup on their head. These days, they might dress up in like a green morph suit or sort of a yellow morph suit, whatever your club's colours are. And another form of fancy dress, something that's a bit unusual, would be to put the club shirt on. And that's what a few people did. So here we've got Newcastle fans, 74 Cup final. All these photos here, you can't see them very clearly. They have people wearing shirts in. And that's a Man United fan in the Trafalgar Square in 77 wearing a United shirt as well. Again, you can see he's really squeezed into it. He's at the sleeves only. But I think that's an important moment that you have adults starting to wear replica shirts, even if it is as fancy dress. If they bought them, they'll go back in the wardrobe. Okay, now the evidence though that it's still not a thing by 1980, a guy called Desmond Morris, he's quite a famous anthropologist, he wrote a book called The Soccer Tribe. There's a few nods there. If you haven't got this and you like football, even if you're not massively into sports history, I'd massively recommend it. It is really, really good and quite funny looking back. Anyway, he had a section called The Adornments of the Followers. he sketched all these photos of fans, and like some have got scars tied around ankles, etc. Lots of denim. Oh, I'm about to conk out. No, I'm all right. And he mentioned all these different things that fans wore. Not once did he mention a replica shirt. Now, this guy was very, it's particular for detail. He didn't see a replica shirt. It clearly wasn't a thing by 1981. So they're not being worn to games in the early 80s. That matched up with our photos. So we looked at our photos, and in your run-of-the-mill league game, there's just nothing happening early 80s. Like one in a 200 photos, we saw a shirt. And really, throughout the 1980s, this is up to 1986, you're hardly seeing any shirts being worn. There's a very gradual rise there. The takeoff happens in two stages. There's a takeoff from about 87 up to 1992. So it's sustained, even though football got, with a little bit of bigger spike around 1990, I guess what that is. And then in 92, 93, it shoots right up and it's stayed about that level. Okay. So I'll talk about the reasons for that in a bit. But obviously, people weren't wearing shirts in the 1980s, even though adult sizes were starting to be produced. Why might that be? Well, there were reasons not to wear shirts in the 1980s to games. Very clear one. I gave quite a few nods. And a lot of this came out in our survey. Can't go to pubs after the match because bouncers won't let you in. And then the classic addition to that, also birds don't find them attractive. I like wearing terrace fashion and labels. I felt it was something only children should do. That's a really important barrier. We'll talk about that again a bit later. Road men should never wear a replica shirt to a match. I used to fight at football, so did not want to be recognised and look like a Christmas tree. And I think the last one is the one that's the one of the biggest barriers. During the 1980s, especially going to away games, it was advisable to not even wear a scarf. Yeah. Okay, so what I've done here is lined up my graphs for parading, promotion and production. Top is production, here's the promotion, here's the parading. And you can see the little breaks where the pattern changes all line up. So clearly there are distinct periods here where the fashion, or the likelihood of people wearing replica shirts, as a thing changes. And this is what I think they are. Pre-1980, ad hoc production and purchasing of adult size replica shirts at very low level from the early 70s. Parading only at cup finals or big games as fancy dress. Replica shirt industry is entirely child focused. 1980 to 1988, low level parading, very slowly increasing despite minimal promotion to adults, and somewhat really being promoted to adults, and small scale production. You can get them, you start seeing adverts saying small and medium adult, but they're not the main focus. 1988 to 1992, shirt wearing takes off among young adults. Increasing purchasing and parading, but it really is by the younger adults as opposed to older fans. And then finally, post 1992, we've got promotion production, increasing to larger size, and middle-aged fans, as well as young adults wearing them. That's where we are now, all fans. Might be seen in a shirt all ages, all genders. Right, the why. Why is there this pattern? Well, let's think about pre-1980. There were social economic barriers to adults wearing sportswear before, certainly 1970. What was those? Well, before 1970, if you wore any sportswear out on the street, people would say, are you going to play sport? They just think you're a bit odd. It just wasn't the dumb thing. If you wore a football shirt, people would say, do you reckon yourself a bit? You think you're in the team? This is what everyone was telling us, and the older adults I know have confirmed this. Just very odd. The other thing was a lot of football shirts were quite bright colours. And wearing bright colours just wasn't a thing for older adults. You'd just be a bit of a dandy, a bit odd. I don't quite know how to put it, but it just wouldn't have been acceptable. And then obviously, in the late 60s, early 70s, you get changing expressions of what masculinity is about. Glam rock. I mean, the guys up on stage were wearing all sorts. And that filters through and it becomes more acceptable. Fashion, early 70s fashion, very bright shirts. It was more acceptable for adults to wear bright colours. Amongst younger people, those youth subcultures have started to have an impact. Clothing becomes something that's a statement. It's not just something you wear. It's something that you're willing to wear to tell other people about yourself. The wearing of sportswear more generally becomes acceptable in the 70s as well. There are two ways this happens. There's the boom in jogging and fitness that's come across from America. So it now becomes acceptable to like go out jogging wearing a tracksuit. You don't see many people wearing tracksuits in the 1960s. In the late 70s, marathons, the London Marathon, well, it all becomes a thing. The other thing is that you have amongst young people particular fashions based on sportswear that have developed. Fred Perry shirts, and then the whole casual scene. Now, your football casuals, they didn't, and they've never really got into wearing replica kits. But they did pave the way for sportswear to become acceptable among a wider group of young people. It became very fashionable. So, there's a few pictures there. I mean, there's a lad there wearing a golf visor, and another one in a Toshini top, Pringle. All this sort of stuff that people brought back from Europe and wore to look cool on the terraces. However, before the 1980s, replica kits have been really, as I said, targeted at young people, and that almost threw up another barrier for adults adopting them. Because for about 15 years, since 1959, through to sort of 20 years really, replica kits were purely a child thing. So in the mind of the population, replica kits are for children. It's become established as a child's thing. And that forms another barrier for adults adopting them. So that's the pre-1980 period. How's that being broken down? Well, it's this Trojan horse of cut final fancy dress. There's a sort of wardrobe inertia. Children who've grown up with replica kits in the 70s keep them in the wardrobe. They get a bit bigger. They want the bigger size. They're used to wearing them. And there's also the beginnings of a wider social phenomenon, the idea of kid-altered adolescence, as people call it, the idea that you can keep wearing your jeans when you're 30 or 40 rather than when you're just 18 to 25. So all those things come together and they break down the barrier. And really the barriers have been moved out of the way by the early 80s, but in their place become other barriers. So if you look in the early 80s, you can see the productions there, as we talked about. You can see visibilities there. The 1982 World Cup, first time you get the England shirt regularly marketed in an adult size and it's being worn. You think adult replica shirts will take off early 80s? No, they don't, for the reasons I talked about earlier. Simply, football violence is a problem. You don't want to be picked out. And football itself becomes deeply unfashionable. In the 1980s, football is not cool. So you wouldn't wear a replica shirt out on the street and be identified as a football fan, because half the people will go, he's a hooligan, and the other half want to beat you up. So that stops it taking off straight away. And it also hinders the promotion and distribution. At that point, we talked to a lot of the club shop managers and production people, and they said, I said, well, why didn't you sort of go for pushing shirts to adults sort of after the 82 World Cup when you started seeing adults wearing them a bit? And they said, to be honest, at that time, all we were trying to do was survive. We weren't trying to innovate. Football was just dying on its feet. So we've just got to keep the market we had, let alone find a new one. And that's a really good example. That's the Luton Town supporters shop. I'm a Watford fan, so I hate Luton. But it's such a great picture. Look at the state of that. It's not a mega store, is it? There's no infrastructure. There's no infrastructure for merchandising in the late 70s, early 80s. It hasn't developed. So you can't just suddenly upscale something and go, we're going to sell this to adults, because there's not places to sell the stuff. There's no cultural capital in being a fan, basically. And actually, that does feed into the way shirts do develop, because if you did wear a shirt in the 80s, and I did from probably about 1985, 86, it was quite a hardcore thing to do, and it marked you out as a hardcore fan. So the growth of shirts there was a much more organic one. It wasn't a promotion-led one. It was the fact that small numbers of shirts, shirt-wearing fans from through the 1980s, were the real hardcore. You were brave enough to just go to games, let alone wear a shirt. So this lad there behind the fences at Man U. So then you get to the late 80s, and football violence starts to decrease. And people always put a line on this and say, the Premier League, say football. This is absolute nonsense. I'm sure a lot of you know. The nadir for football is 85, 86. And then it starts to fight back. And that fight back is very much an organic thing. It's led by people running fanzines. It's led by active fans on the terraces who've said, enough is enough. We don't want this. It's led by the police introducing closed circuit TV. So anybody fighting in the ground is easily picked out. So people fight less in the grounds, it moves outside. And it changes. There becomes a terrace counterculture. Football starts to become fun again. And it's a totally organic fan-led process, because to be honest, the terraces are a wasteland that have been deserted to the fans. There's no attempt by the club to control, because they're just clinging on with their fingertips in terms of staying in business. They're not trying to promote lots of glossy offers to fans. So it leaves a space where fans can develop things themselves. A terrace counterculture develops. I said fanzines, inflatables, if anybody remembers inflatables, very much a fan-led thing. Going to games just became a lot more fun. I think it's my favourite period of going to football, probably is the late 80s, because at that point it was reviving, but it hadn't been over-commercialised. And part of that feeds back into sort of young adult fashion. At that point, the music scene and football start to cross over amongst young adults. I think if you'd said to people in the 1985, you go to football when you're at a gig, the rest of the people at the gig would have gone, oh, he goes to football, he's going to beat us up. But by 1988-89, football is hip again. And you get this, basically, crossover where things that are regarded as widely fashionable among young adults start to reference football, and it comes back. Kate Moss was on her first cover appearance, was on the front of the Face wearing football gear before Italia 90. There's a quote from the NME, football is hip again. That's reflected on a rock and roll level. That's from 1989. And then obviously the World Cup song 1990, really key moment, World in Motion, coolest band at the time, you order, certainly one of them. They're doing the football song and they're wearing shirts in it. And that just makes the point that at that point, shirts have become cool amongst young people. You start seeing them among lots of young people on the terraces. Now, manufacturers aren't stupid. They see this and they think, we're going to make a lot of money out of shirts now. And kit deals start going up a lot. So I think the first million kit deal, 1992, Man United and Umbro. And you've spent a million on a kit deal. The guy from Umbro told me, we paid a million for the rights to Man United shirt. We thought, we're going to have to sell a lot of shirts. We've got to sell shirts to different people, not just the young adults who made them fashionable. We want to sell shirts to the real grown-ups as well. And so they start doing larger sizes. They start designing them to appeal to older people. Shirts become a lot more baggy around that time as well, early mid-90s shirts. The shorts become longer, though that's not really relevant to wearing them for the game, but everything becomes bigger. And design changes happen as well. I think if you remember the late 80s, early 90s, there were some very garish shirts. By the mid-90s, it sobers down again, because no adult's going to want to go out wearing a thing with about three different patterns all over it. So shirt design really sobered up. And there started to be a return to sort of nostalgic designs as well, which has carried on to this day. There's always now, really from the early 90s onwards, kit design has really tried to use nostalgia, harking back to previous designs. You've now got a distribution network as well. By the late 80s, football had got a bit more of a grip on merchandising, and you've got bigger sportswear companies as well. So you've got the Man United Megastore there, you've got JJB Sports. You've got this what called hyper-commodification, the complete commercialisation to a ridiculous extent of the Premier League. Just using it to sell stuff to people. And that's continued to this day. So, I mean, the hyper-commodification of the shirt has just continued constantly and constantly over the last 20-odd years. How many different kits do teams wear a season now? I mean, 4 or 5 at least, just special editions for games, don't you? There's price differentiation. Some clubs now sell a stadium shirt and a match shirt. The stadium shirt being of a cheaper material. The match version is made exactly the same as the players would wear material. We charge like 150 for that. This sort of stuff. Look on the Chelsea website. You can see all this nonsense. You have digital kits, like a kit that's a concept design that was never going to be worn, but it's got the club badge on and you can buy it for a limited period on the website. That Man United leopard skin one was one of my favourites, I suppose. Why would anybody ever wear that? It's just disgusting. But, and then we start getting women's cuts, another new market. It's all about selling more and more and more and more. So the focus is on. It's amazing how late women's cuts came, given that women have been going to football for the whole period. And then you've got now a crossover with high fashion. I mean, football kits now receive an awful lot of attention from the public, from designers. You will get special crossover editions like Adidas times Louis Vuitton and this sort of nonsense. Really, really weird stuff out there. At the same time, you've also got this continual nostalgia-driven market for second-hand replicas on eBay, things like classic football shirts, Maradona's match-worn shirt going for, however, was it 7 million? It all feeds in. It all feeds in. The idea you can monetize any old bit of polyester. Okay, just a few conclusions to finish with. Three things here. The first one, I think, any sort of sports history is only interesting to me if it maps onto wider things. I think if you just look at the shirt we wore in 1976, it's interesting for a brief moment as, how nostalgic. But I think there's much more depth into it if you try and map it onto things that happen in wider society. So the gentrification narrative, I think replica shirt adoption fits very, very neatly onto the ideas of the gentrification process. So initially we have that period of slow decline in English football attendances and general well-being of the game that happened from mid-70s through to the mid to late 80s. And that decline created a space in which an alternative football culture could begin to flourish. And shirts were part of the fashion of those initial tastemakers. And then that in turn made football and replica shirts a very attractive proposition for new investors. I also think there's a key point about the rewriting of history. The idea that the Premier League changed football that I alluded to a minute ago. It is very much the case that people think that businesses are the leaders and they change everything. But actually, many things grow from the grassroots, and shirts are a really good example of that. The initial purchasing and parading precedes promotion of adult shirts. We're really only seeing adult size replica shirts starting to be promoted properly in the late 80s, but really only the early 90s are serious efforts made. And young adults have adopted them before then. They've adopted them from the late 80s in large numbers. The adult replica kit industry was effectively launched in the mid to late 80s by young adult fans continuing to wear replica shirts, having grown out of their child sizes, and by hardcore fans thinking, I'm going to wear a replica shirt even if I might get beaten up, and making it this countercultural fashion item. It's not been initially stimulated by manufacturers or retailers. And that late 80s growth, as I said, that was stimulated by youth subcultural fashion changes, predates the launch of the Premier League by 3 or 4 years. And it points to the fact that football was beginning to revive before the Premier League came along. It wasn't the Premier League, all seats, stadiums, etc., that saved football. Fans were saving football from the late 80s onwards. Fans made it into a proposition that was investable. So if anybody tells you football changed with the Premier League, or even with Gazza's tears in the 1990 World Cup. So a little bit before then, 86, 87, 88, I would say, 88, 89. That's when you can see the green shoots happening. Final thing, uniforms and uniformity. I think shirts speak very much on how we as people want to fit in, but we also want to be individuals. And they're very much, they're a piece of clothing that there's a space for it in anyone's wardrobe for a shirt of some kind, that's the way they've developed. Football shirts are really mainstream adult clothing now, worn by almost anyone and everyone. For some fans, not wearing the current replica has become the way to be an authentic fan. I'm not someone who shops at the club shop with all the promotion. I'm cooler than that. Which is a complete turnaround since the 1980s, where if you wore a shirt, replica, to a game, you were the real authentic fan. You weren't brave enough to wear it. Now, I'm the one who's brave enough to ignore the club hype and merchandising. I'm a real fan. And so they illustrate that tension between wanting to fit in and wanting to be an individual. I think if you see a crowd like that, all blue shirts, you're becoming, you look like a bit of a sheep if you're just another blue shirt in there, in some people's minds anyway. But even the fans who really abhor that commercialism and don't like it, a lot of them still buy shirts. They'll buy retro replicas, they'll buy obscure non-league shirts, they'll be like me, CD Guadalajara of the Mexican League, same colours as Watford, I'm a Watford fan. Don't want to buy the Watford shirt at the moment, so I'm with that. Duke of Prague away kit, I'm in a record shop, I'm a massive Hoffman Hoff biscuit fan, people who might get that, a few nods. In the late modern world, it's almost impossible not to be a consumer, that's the point I'm making. And shirts just show that very, very well. You can't avoid them. Okay. I hope that was interesting, and if anybody's got any questions, then feel free to ask. By the way, just to say before I take questions, if you want to come and scan that thing later, I wrote an academic paper on this, and you can access it free online. I paid for it to be made free online, and even though it's an academic paper, it is quite chatty. It's not football words, so feel free to download and read. Hold out. Is it going to hold out? Yes. Okay. Any questions?
Yeah, can I just put a bit of context? I grew up as a kid in Skipton. In the early 60s, I remember playing football against a lot of kids in Burnley shirts, obviously the success of Burnley. I'm trying really hard to remember if those shirts had badges on or not.
Well, you could buy them. You could buy a separate badge. So they were probably Umbro sets or something like that for one of these companies that made these kids' replicas.
Coming back into the early 70s, I moved to London to college. My college played in London South West League Division 5. That's how good we were. In context, our captain, who actually, with the context of today, was a Northampton Town supporter, he said, lads, next year we're going to play in the AC Milan shirt because they just won. I think they've been very successful in Europe. And now coming on to the late 70s, when I lived in London, I used to go to Tottenham. Now in Tottenham, in the autumn 1978, weren't a lot of Spurs shirts, but there were a bloody lot of Argentina shirts.
Yeah.
Because Spurs had just signed Ozzyard Inglis and Ricardo Villa, and obviously Argentina just won the World Cup. And they were proper shirts, and they did have the Argentinian badge on.
Yeah, that was just like I said, the 78, 79, the first season that actually some manufacturers started making adult sizes. And it was like I said, Man United, Liverpool, England, Scotland, and I think Umbro did Argentina at the time. They probably did some Argentinian ones.
This was this one, just one or two things. This one.
Yeah.
Going to Spurs games at autumn.
It helps the colours as well. The white and the light blue fits okay.
Okay, just a bit of context.
Yeah.
Chris, I've got, thanks for that. That's really interesting. Just a general question. I understand how it's developed, but why is it developed? Why are we all sat here in replica shirts now? Is what's the did your research tell you why people were buying them?
Well, I think it was. I mean, why did children wear them as kids?
Also, why adults wear them now?
Well, the same reasons. Initially, kids grew up wearing replica. I think those are sort of three reasons that it crossed over from children to adults. You've got, firstly, part of that, I want to support my team, wear the colours, be a hero like my heroes. I think there's a bit of that. And that certainly isn't children buying them, but then becomes an adult. You've got the wardrobe inertia that happens. Essentially, you've got stuff in your wardrobe when you're a kid, and it stopped being a thing that the moment you became an adult, you started wearing a shirt and tie. That stopped in the 70s, early, 60s, 70s, 80s. And people started having more sets of clothes and wearing leisure wear as outdoor wear. And you've got your Cubs football kit that was something you wore as a kid as leisure wear. You've adopted it as an adult leisure wear. You've kept wearing it. You've gone through this sort of teenage period where you've kept your younger things, and that teenage period is extended and extended. I mean, it's the whole thing, people talk about adolescence or kidhood. I think it's partly explained by greater numbers of people going to university. So you have that period. You don't just go straight from school into a suit and tie. You go from school into university, and suddenly you're like 21, 22, and you're still wearing t-shirt and jeans around everywhere. Okay, now you're wearing football shirt and jeans. So I think that helped bridge it. And I think the other reason, as I said, there was the sort of Trojan horse of cup finals. I think they got people wearing them to games. Initially, it was cup finals and big games as fancy dress. But people have them. They keep them in their wardrobe again. And it just gradually becomes acceptable. Why do people do it in a conscious way as a sort of pro rather than not a barrier to it? Like I said, I think it's really to do with wanting to be part of something. It's showing your support for a team. It's also showing your authenticity as a fan. And that's why I think people keep wearing shirts, even if they're not going to wear the current one. People have been going and want to show what a real hardcore fan they are. They can do that by wearing an old shirt. So that person is showing off, I've been a fan for this many years. I remember when they wore that kit. Remember the retro replica industry that started about 1990, Arkwrights and Toft shirts, massively popular, because it enabled a whole group of people who wouldn't want to be seen as commercial and wearing the current shirt to suddenly buy into the thing. So the answer is lots and lots of different reasons. There's no one reason why become popular.
Thank you, Chris. I think that's the most questions we've ever had, so that's a big one. I was looking at Keith when he was mentioning the deeply unfashionable cardigans.
Really enjoyed it. There's a lot of questions beyond, Max. I'm not going to recognise this.